Right, okay, so the Buddha's teaching is there are 12 nidanas. That's quite clear. Independence on... I should leave it to you, shouldn't I? Independence upon ignorance arises...
Samskaras.
The blind potter. He shapes things from his own karma. Independence on samskaras arises...
Consciousness.
Vinyana. Depends on conscious arises?
Name and form.
It depends on name and form arises?
The six senses.
Nama rupa, six senses. It depends on six senses?
Contact.
It depends on contact?
Feeling.
Still staying on the circle?
Feeling.
After feeling?
Craving.
After craving? Grasping after grasping,
becoming
after becoming,
death. And then ignorance again.
Death, well, it's actually death and rebirth, isn't it?
Death,
yes. So, those are the nidanas, and that in the texts, most often you'll see that you reflect in that way. You just start with the first one, ignorance, and you reflect, I have ignorance. Because I'm ignorant, I act in a certain way, and I become a certain sort of person. That's my samskaras, isn't it? Okay, and when I die, well then I'm reborn with a certain type of consciousness. Because I have the consciousness, it also has to have a body, so I have nama and rupa. And because I've got nama rupa, okay, well then I've got the senses, because everybody's got senses. And because I've got senses, I've then got contact. Because I've got contact, I feel things. Now, none of that I can do anything about. Because as soon as I've got consciousness, I'm reborn in this world, everything's going to happen right up to feelings. What sort of feelings? Painful feelings. Neutral feelings. Don't know much about them. And pleasant feelings. Yes. Chocolate, ice cream, sex, all the rest of it. Then you move on from there. After feeling, craving, grasping, becoming, birth, old age, death. But I can do something about the feeling, can't I? Yes. Mm-hmm. Okay. And up to death. And then having got to death, and the image in the Wheel of Life, of course, is the man taking the corpse to the cremation ground, you then go backwards. Since I'm suffering in this world, it all comes about because of what I've been doing. So, yes, in this life, I've gone through birth, old age and death because I was born. And before then, in my previous life, the same cycle went on. But I did have a choice. I didn't have to act in the way that I should have and become a certain sort of person. That wasn't inevitable. I could have not grasped so much. I could have not craved so much. But, you know, because I had feelings, the feelings came back because I had a body. And that body only went all the way back to consciousness taking rebirth. And there's the cycle. So what should I do? I should go for refuge and practice seriously. So in a way, the 12 nidanas are a practice of renunciation. You go forward, and then you think, well, it's not good enough because I suffer in this world. So let's undo it. By reflection, let's develop insight into the process. Let's go backwards. And that's one of the most common ways. And if you look up in the meditation text, it'll tell you how to do it. Bhante discovered there's another way that the Buddha speaks of the nidanas, the 12 positive nidanas that follow on from the point of feeling. Feeling. Everything from consciousness through to feeling is vipaka. It's as a result of the previous situation. But from feeling onwards, there's a choice. So what's the choice? You've already said it. Independence on a certain type of painful feeling arises.
Faith.
Faith. Shraddha. And so then, looking at my list here, after faith arises joy, after joy, rapture can arise, pacification, bliss, samadhi, knowledge of vision of things as they really are, in other words, insight, and then the transcendental stages of withdrawal, dispassion, freedom, and knowledge and destruction of the ashravas. That's the Buddha's teaching. That part's got lost. It's not lost, it's there in the Pali text if you want to look at it. There are even a few other lists that are very similar, similar in tone, but they're not usually appended to the wheel at the point of faith. The beauty of this particular one is that this particular spiral path starts at the spiral at the point of faith. So, in a way, actually, what we've got is we've got two sets of 12. One is a set which is commonly used for renunciation, moving away from something, moving away from this painful world, from this difficult world, from this unsatisfactory world, from this world without any substance to it. Whereas the other 12 are going for refuge too. It is a sort of going for refuge, isn't it? Because you see that there's something beyond just suffering, something that you want in this world. You're not quite sure what it is, and it won't become clear what it is until you get the insight. But it's a going for refuge too. Whereas the other set of 12 nidanas, in a way, are a going for refuge from. Going for refuge from the world, going for refuge to the transcendental. So Bhante's spiral path has got the positive vision encapsulated within it, or the Buddha's spiral path has got the positive encapsulated within it. Dr. Ambedkar, of course, is very concerned that in any teaching that's put forward in the Buddhist path, it's got to be based on the positive. His people have been, they've had hundreds and hundreds of years being kept at the bottom of the pile, basically as slaves, basically as being used persons, and being kept separate from society, separate from any way forward whatsoever. So he doesn't want anything that ennobles poverty. That's a complete no-no in his philosophy. It's maybe fine for those who've got lots of property and lots of possibility to think in terms of renunciation. But for him, renunciation doesn't strike a bell for him or his community. What strikes a bell is what can be gained. What is the positive way forward? So in a sense, this looking, always Dr. Ambedkar looking for positive formulations of the path, is very, very much in key with Bhante's choice of the spiral path as being one of the primary conceptualizations of the path. Dr. Ambedkar uses the Noble Eightfold Path as a positive formulation. He even uses the six perfections. He uses the six perfections in the Buddha and his Dhamma quite early on. And the six perfections is as a specific Mahayana formulation. It's not there in the Pali texts. If there are paramitas, it's usually the ten paramitas, and there are two versions of the ten paramitas. But Babasaheb chooses in the earlier part of the Buddha and his Dhamma to point out that there are six wonderful perfections that could be cultivated and that could bring something to the life of any one of his community, starting with generosity, starting with and following on with morality, following on with
patience,
concentration, effort, and wisdom. Also the six paramitas are also divided into a section of body, section of speech, and section of mind. There are also the Noble Eightfold Path divides into body, speech, and mind. So again, this conversion of Babasaheb's, that is people must work on body, speech, and mind, the whole being, in other words. So this is, really not the 12 Nidanas, although it's not commonly found in other Buddhist traditions. Very few people argue with us that it's Buddhist. They're quite surprised sometimes that it's emphasized in our tradition. But when they see what it is, they do appreciate it generally. And in India, when we talk about the Nidanas, people are usually very, very pleased to hear about these Nidanas, especially the Nidanas, thinking of joy, bliss, and so on. Very often now, our Buddhists in India, the ones connected with Trilokya Bhadama Sangha, come to our classes and learn meditation. And because they learn meditation, they very often have experiences in meditation. They're generally very good at meditating. We sit down and we've got all sorts of this and that and the other, But sometimes for our Buddhist community in India, it's much more simple than that. Maybe their simpler lifestyle, maybe with the mobile phones nowadays, maybe it's changing a bit. Since I've left India 6 years ago, everybody in our Buddhist community, as far as I can see, they've all got mobile phones. But, certainly 10 years ago, 15 years ago, 20 years ago, people found it generally very easy to meditate. Perhaps more difficult other things, like keeping silence and turning up to things on time. But, when they get there, they sit down to meditate and they can generally still the mind. And they do have experiences, very often, akin to the earlier stage of the spiral path. Very often they'll tell you the visions that they have, that come, the feelings that they have that arise in their mind, and sometimes even their body being shaken by bliss, and sometimes tears coming in their eyes. Very often people come in to meditate for the first time, having left their slum. And sometimes the slums really are, they're just awful. Just awful. And they come to the Vihara. Maybe it's Mahavihara, beautiful Vihara. Maybe it's not such a beautiful one. Maybe it's just a corridor in the slum. And it's got a Buddha image at one end and a couple of Dhammacharis or Dhammacharinis sitting by the Buddha and other people just sitting down facing the Buddha, maybe chanting the refuges and precepts. They sit down to meditate, and then sometimes you just see tears under their eyes. Something beautiful is happening in the world. Extraordinary. My first experience of this was on my first visit to India in 1986, well, 85, 86. It was 85. Because it was December the 6th, was my first day, the death anniversary of Dr. Ambedkar. And I was there on the beach where his stupa is, where hundreds of thousands of people come every year just to pay their respect to their leader. And I was amazed. But that evening I was asked, would I give a talk in Babasaheb's college that he set up in Mumbai, Siddharth College of Arts and Sciences. And I said, okay, well, I don't know what I'll talk on, but I'll give a short talk. I remember the talk, doesn't matter about the talk, but before the talk, we did a little bit of meditation, and there were people there who'd come to the beach that day to pay their respects, plus the regulars who came to that sort of venue. But some of the people who came, they came in sacking. You know what sacks are? For, you, when you when you bag up grain, corn, from the field, you bag it up in these big straw sacks. They had clothing that was just like that. So poor. And there was one old man sitting just by the side, not far from where I was, just sitting to the side of the audience. And as we were meditating, I could see just tears coming down his eyes. And he probably had been there with Dr. Ambedkar in 1956, converting to Buddhism. He was old enough for that. And, you know, it just really struck me that this is real for them. This is real. This is not play. This is this man's life. Okay. Moving on from the Nidanas. I said I would do a third topic today, didn't I? And it would be the higher evolution. And again, maybe not so long on this one. In the Buddha's own day, of course, there's no concept of evolution. Evolution didn't really come into play as a concept, not until the 1800s. Perhaps a little bit before. There's some scholars are trying to sort of push back the date that there were scholars, biologists and so on, thinking of it in terms of evolution. But actually, way, way back, there's not really a concept of evolution as we think of it. The Buddha himself talks in terms of growth and development, and his own vision after enlightenment is of a lotus pond, and that beings are just like lotuses, all in different stages of development. See, there's something there, there's a connection there, but it's not the concept of evolution. And he does see in terms of conditionality, that independence upon this, these people can develop. Independence upon that, they could develop more. And hence, you know, his teaching of things like the Noble Eightfold Path, the Paramitas, and the Spiral Path. He also speaks about, he asks the question, what is the greatest miracle of all? And I imagine that when he asks this question, he waits for the answer, and either people guess and get it wrong, or he waits and they're all silent. And so he says, well, the greatest miracle of all is that human beings can change. And that's quite a statement. Human beings can change. There's his whole philosophy just in a sentence. And then, of course, in the White Lotus Sutra of the Mahayana, there's the reign of the Dhamma that rains down on all the plants, and each of them grow according to their own nature. Small bushes grow as small bushes, flowers grow as flowers, great trees grow as great trees. So again, this sort of image of growth according to their own nature. He does speak in terms of a cycle of development, which is very close to the concept of evolution, because he talks in terms of the ins and outs of the universe. So in one of the suttas, he speaks about the universe developing it to its fullness, all beings getting enlightened, all beings growing and developing, or all beings not getting enlightened, but all beings going up to the heights, the most refined point that they can, where consciousness is the most refined, and it's the most separated from matter. And then the universe collapses, and then evolves again. And he speaks about this evolution, the involution, and the evolution of the universe. It's not actually involution and evolution, there are different words than that, but in a way it comes to the same sort of thing. And then there's also his vision of the six realms of existence. And we know that there's a vision of six realms of existence because he speaks in terms, in the Pali texts, of asking for an image of it to be raised above one of his parks, where he, you know, which he was given as a gift, where he would go and reside in the rainy season. But at the gate to the park, he wanted a wheel of life to be erected. Now, what it was like, we don't know. Whether it actually had, you know, the same divisions as the wheel of life that the Tibetans have or not, we don't know. But it's an image, and it's of the six realms. Well, no, we don't know it's the six realms. It could be five. Could be five, it's possible. But he wants that to be raised up there. But, you know, even the image of the wheel of life, it's not an image in terms of a wheel going round. Not really, in terms of it changing and developing. It's done according, you know, to not time, but to the poisons. So the universe is divided up into five or six poisons. So each realm being characteristic of one particular poison. Say, for instance, the poison of ignorance for animals, the poison of pride, and the poison of jealousy, and so on. So, you know, even there, he doesn't really speak in terms of evolution. Bhante speaks in terms of evolution, and, you know, specifically he gave a series of talks on the higher evolution of man, as he called it then. I think it probably called mankind now, or humankind, and spoke in terms of that evolution being a double evolution of matter and consciousness. So the two are going together, and there are characteristics of that evolution, that the evolution is a natural process. It's a process which is involuntary, that nobody takes, nobody decides, I'm going to evolve now from a snail into, you know, whatever. So it also requires no effort, and it's based on the biological. So being biological, of course, it's also collective, because the genes are kept within the pool of biology. So we've got lower evolution being biological, collective, unconscious, and requiring no effort. And it's an evolution from. Whereas the higher evolution, which he goes on to outline, is not biological, it's individual, it's conscious, and it requires effort. It requires conscious effort, and it's an evolution too, an evolution of developing consciousness towards awareness and creativity, etc. Bhante works out the implications of that evolution in different areas. So, for instance, he looks at it historically, that there's an axial age where the first great arising of awareness comes in the world in different places, in China, in Greece, and so on. Then he works out it in terms of religion being ethnic and universal. And then he works it out in terms of a path of higher evolution. And of course that path of higher evolution is everything else that Bhante talks of almost in all the other talks that he gives. But it's not the only place that he talks of the higher evolution. He gives another series of talks, the eight talks. Is that us? No? Somebody else making that noise?
It's a hedge cutter, I think.
It will be, yes, a hedge cutter. Okay, well, Bhante also gives the talk on the higher evolution of the individual, and works out, again, from that dual evolution of consciousness and matter, works out that the individual has to take the evolution into his or her own hands and make the efforts. And the individual will find certain themes coming up. So, for instance, in terms of awareness being alienated or not alienated, and so on. So he works out the implications of that evolution in different departments of the spiritual life. But he also speaks in terms of the higher evolution of the individual in terms of the bodhisattva ideal. And he gave that wonderful talk which knocked the socks off everybody, called The Bodhisattva, Evolution and Self-Transcendence, where he took the theme of evolution and to a conference of mystics and scientists outlined how the Bodhisattva ideal really is evolution in progress. Babasaheb's approach, in a way, it could have gone down that line, but it didn't, because he was very well aware of evolution. Of course, he's a highly educated man at the beginning of the 20th century. And, of course, you know, his education will have included, you know, everything that you know, was there from Darwin. So, yes, in the 19th century, Darwin publishes his great thesis on the evolution of the species. And from that point onwards, evolution catches on, and evolution is applied to everything. And Dr. Ambedkar himself applies it. And his first published work is The Evolution of Provincial Finance in British India. That was his thesis. That was his first thesis. So he looks at the problems in India to do with finance, and he looks at how the whole thing of finance has developed in terms of evolution. It hasn't just arrived, it's come about because of certain conditions. So he applies the principles of evolution. And then he applies it also to Indian civilization. How has Indian civilization evolved to what it is now? So in a way, in anthropology, he sort of applies it there, and specifically when it comes to examining who were the Shudras, in other words, the fourth of the four the lowest of the four castes, who were the Shudras, and then he applies it to who were the untouchables, the ones who were below that fourth lowest caste, below the Shudras, the Ati Shudras, in other words. So he applies evolutionary principles to many, many things in his talks. But sadly, he sort of missed the opportunity of thinking, well, what about evolution and the Dhamma? Perhaps he would have got to that in time. But as it was, time was running out by the time he converted, and he only lived for just 6 weeks after he had died. And even his thesis, well, his Buddhist Bible, is really half of it is just a series of notes, great notes, you know, very thoughtful notes, but notes nevertheless. Perhaps he would have gone much further. So he does know about evolution. He does apply it, and one area which he does apply it to is that he sees that his community must develop a culture of the mind. And his in terms of talking about the culture of the mind, he talks of this being one of the conditions in which it will transform the whole of Indian society. He sees that Indian society was in a certain way at a certain point. Many things happened that of the Hindu caste system coming in, so many things were debased. So the Shudras themselves got an even worse deal. The Ati Shudras, the so-called untouchables, got an even worse deal. The Hindu woman got one of the worst deals of all, because she had gender, she had class, and she had caste or outcaste to deal with. And Ambedkar himself judged the evolution of Indian society by the progress that women would make. Very interesting sort of way to look at how a culture develops. He says that he would look at the development of Indian culture and determine success by the success with which women rose up. So, yes, he did think in terms of evolution, and I'm sure he would have, appreciated the anthropological note that Bhante takes with his evolution and mankind, and his later religious tack that he takes, looking at religion, ethnic and universal. So, with that third topic, I'm going to leave today's topics. So, I don't know if you have any questions you want to ask, or is it enough?
Around livelihood. I can see the importance of how for people who've converted to Buddhism, how changing those circumstances is particularly important. But I wonder over time how that's worked. Has it been positive? People have managed to find different situations to gain a livelihood.
Very positive. Babasaheb had a three-word motto: educate, agitate, organize. Yeah. So educate was the way forward. So he was very, very insistent that we should value I don't even have any children that our Indian members should value their children, boys and girls, and send them for education. And that education for them would be one of the ways out of this situation. And the conversions took place primarily amongst the Mahar community of Maharashtra. And they were the largest untouchable community of Maharashtra. One of the largest in the whole of India. And Dr. Ambedkar himself was from the Mahar community. So, of course, he had the greatest number of followers amongst his own community. So they all converted en masse. Not them all, but a lot of them converted. And since then, many, many more. And they have taken very seriously this thing about education. With the result that in India now, one of the most highly educated communities in the whole of India is the Mahar community. Mm-hmm. In other words, the new Buddhist community of India. The one where the best rate for sending girls for education is amongst the Mahars. The best rate for exam passes, and so on and so on. There was a little handbook that somebody had in India of the statistics that were brought out in the newspapers over the years. Mm-hmm. There were some wonderful statistics. Mm-hmm. So yes, the educated community amongst the new Buddhists have got themselves, with degrees, got themselves with MBAs, Master of Business Administration and so on, Master of Business Studies, Master of Social Work, and they're finding their livelihoods. So much so now that many of the communities that didn't convert to Buddhism 50, 60 years ago regret now that they've lagged behind. They can look at their own community and they can see that health issues are worse, housing issues are worse, social, political, educational rights are worse. Now they begin to think, well, we should have converted. And many of them are converting.
Encouraging to hear.
Yes, mm-hmm. Yes. So, with education, again, comes, the door is open to other jobs. Mm-hmm. And, of course, it's now accepted in the cities, at least, that when you get educated, you can apply for any job, and there are reservations in all government departments for certain numbers of people from the backward communities. In villages, and especially not Maharashtrian villages, but villages, say in North India, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar and so on, kids who try and get educated, especially girls who try and get educated, especially girls who get high marks, they're targeted. Because, you know, who are they to, you know, get out of their place? I mean, it's just, it's horrible, it's horrendous. And it still goes on. Yeah. We know that caste is not the same issue as it was 50, 60 years ago, but still, it's still pretty bad. Mm-hmm. And there's still further to go, even in Maharashtra, much further. You know, if you took any of the Indian newspapers every week, you'd see there's some atrocity done by some community against an ex-untouchable girl or boy or couple or whatever.
Well, it's regular. It's not.
Oh, it's regular. Oh, it's regular. Yes. One of the good things is the response that's coming to it now, because there are such things as mass communication, and the young people now are not putting up with what the older people put up with. So, for instance, the rape that occurred last year of a young girl in Delhi who was Dalit, she was from an ex-untouchable community. The outrage that came from that. And not just from the low caste communities, from everybody. So that's happening. But you know, since then, when a few weeks later, a couple of women were raped and hung up. More rapes have happened since then. And especially, it's seen by certain sections of community that Dalit women don't count.
Still.
They don't count. Good enough to have sex with, but they don't count. So it's, you know, I'm shaking here. It's such an issue.
How can it be changed?
Well, it is changing, but...
And you think mass communication is having a significant impact?
Well, one of the things with mass communication is that, you know, everybody's got the mobile phone, so they video something. So, you know, for instance, on another area, the police go into a park, boys and girls, young students basically, are walking around hand in hand. Some of them are sitting by a bush, some of them are embracing, maybe even kissing. The police decide that is immoral. And so, arrest them, beat them up. That's videoed, and then within a couple of days, it becomes a huge issue for the police in that area. The police are not there to enforce morality. They're there to enforce the law. No law was broken. So yes, you've got things like. Just a couple of days ago on the internet, some young hooligans, young boys, get a dog, grab it by the back legs. One of the boys just swings it round, lets it fly. That boy's arrested now.
Because it was on film.
Because it was on film, and 4 million hits. It's gone viral. So yes, I mean there are a whole number of things like that going on. That you know, when there's an issue like that, it can be filmed, and now the Dalit community are trying to get people educated to film anything that goes on like that immediately. Don't think in terms of I'm being, you know, it's wrong. I shouldn't film this. Get it on film. Get the policeman's number. Get the car number, get the bus number on your film. So that helps.
The conversion, going back to the conversion, is it like one of the things that have been said that the reason why the Buddhist community didn't come to the or Ambedkar's people's aid when he died was because it was perceived as a political conversion. What's your view on that?
I think that's probably partly true. I think another reason for it was that the other Buddhist communities coming in to India to help have difficulty with the administration in India. And the administration, of course, back in those days, was 95% in the hands of Brahmins. So they would have had difficulty. Another reason is that, as Babasaheb outlines in his own writings, the monks are a bunch of idlers. They supported, and he got, you know, quite a number of messages of congratulations from different politicians, different countries, different, you know, prime ministers of different countries and so on. Nothing from any politician or any person of prominence in the Hindu community. Nothing at all. But Babasaheb asked Bhante, look, if we convert, will the other Buddhists in the other countries respond? And Bhante tried to be very positive and convince Babasaheb that yes, they would respond. It didn't happen. And in a way, Bhante felt, you know, quite ashamed of the rest of the Buddhist community in Sri Lanka and Burma and Thailand. They didn't respond. They should have. Mm-hmm. And in a way, that's also, I think, part of the reason why when Babasaheb spoke with Bhante and the 57 Buddhists from border areas on the year of that conversion and said to Bhante it was important that this work continue, and Bhante felt that the mantle of responsibility came on him. Part of that, I think, was that Bhante knew the other Buddhists aren't going to respond. And he saw that they didn't respond, so he had to respond.